In the late 1930s, Nazi Germany was increasing their aggression, ignoring the Treaty of Versailles and threatening to spread its empire all over Europe, including a place called the Sudetenland of Czechoslovakia. This was a German-speaking area of about 3 million Czechs. France and Great Britain decided to meet with Hitler, where they agreed to let him take over the Sudetenland if he promised that that would be the extent of his reach to occupy other countries in Eastern Europe. Great Britain's Prime Minister, a man named Neville Chamberlain, came home from the agreement to Great Britain like a hero, thinking that he had just rescued the rest of Europe from the brink of war, all hinging on the good word of Adolf Hitler.
That the settlement of the Czechoslovakian problem, which has now been achieved, is, in my view, only the prelude to a larger settlement in which all Europe may find peace.
The applause didn't last for very long. Just a few months later, on March 15th, 1939, Adolf Hitler and the German army invaded Czechoslovakia. With the invasion, Czechoslovakia was divided apart and, on paper anyway, ceased to exist. But its Latter-day Saints did not. Although the gospel was young and fragile in East Germany and Czechoslovakia, they were led and strengthened by a man who was known as the Moses of the Czech Republic, a man that you likely have never heard of. A man whose name was Wallace F. Toronto.
You look at Hitler, and of course the first place he goes after is Sudetenland and Czechoslovakia. And while he not only knows and sees that in Czechoslovakia, but in Germany, that's what's going on when he's there on his first mission before he gets transferred. So, and not just with Hitler, but then you go through the communist era in Czechoslovakia, and he's right there in the middle of that. So it's an amazing character, not only in church history, but in Slavic history in that part of the world.
Today on Why Religion, Professor Mary Jane Woodger shares insights from her recent church history book called Mission President or Spy, The True Story of Wallace F. Toronto, the Czech Mission, and World War II. Although Hitler and World War II are now decades gone, there are modern lessons to learn from this unsung church history hero. How do saints survive through social and political unrest? How does the kingdom grow when missionaries are evacuated and pulled from preaching? How can the gospel thrive when saints are not allowed to congregate and meet together with their leaders, even for long periods of time? The example of simple but fearless and faithful saints like Wally Toronto is how. And there are thousands of Wally Torontos around the world. My name is Professor Anthony Sweat, and this is Why Religion.
Each year, religion professors at Brigham Young University produce hundreds of publications on subjects related to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. This podcast brings this research into one place to enlighten the everyday seeker of truth.
Seek learning, even by study, and also by faith.
Interviewing the author, we discuss why the study was done, why it matters, and why the professor chooses to be both a scholar and a disciple. This is Why Religion, research to enlighten your mind.
Before we go to Professor Woodger's interview from her colleague, Casey Griffiths, a little history lesson might be helpful to give some background knowledge to their discussion. Remember, Adolf Hitler is going to come to power in Germany in 1933. World War II will begin in September of 1939, when Hitler and the German army invade Poland. World War II was, in many respects, simply a continuation of the disputes that got left unsettled from World War I. The principal combatants in World War II were Germany, Italy, and Japan on the one side, fighting against the Allied forces of France, Great Britain, the United States, and the Soviet Union on the other side. Hitler and the German army rolled over much of Europe, invading 11 surrounding countries between 1939 and 1945. I've already mentioned Poland and Czechoslovakia, but in 1940, the German army will defeat and occupy Denmark, Norway, Belgium, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, and France. The next year, they'll overtake Yugoslavia and Greece. Germany, however, failed to defeat Great Britain or the Soviet Union, who, together with the United States, turned the tide of battle and ultimately will defeat the German army in May of 1945. Hitler will kill himself the month before the victory. On the church side, missionaries are going to come to Czechoslovakia the first time in 1884. In 1918, Czechoslovakia will gain independence, and the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints will establish the Czech Mission in 1929. After Hitler invaded a decade later in 1939, the first presidency directed all North American missionaries to evacuate Czechoslovakia. A young convert whose name was Joseph Rubisek kept the church intact after missionaries left during World War II. Although the Czech Mission will reopen briefly after World War II from 1946 to 1950, it has to close again in 1950 when Communist Soviet Union takes over Czechoslovakia. Communist officials will ban the church from all public activity and expel all foreign missionaries. So from 1950 to 1989, Czechoslovakian church members had only occasional contact with members and leaders outside of the country. You guys, that's nearly 40 years. After the Iron Curtain goes down in February of 1990, Elder Russell M. Nelson will rededicate Czechoslovakia for the preaching of the gospel. And in July of 1990, the church will receive official recognition from the Czechoslovakian government. And just a little tidbit here, in 2004, a man born in Ostrava, Czechoslovakia, will be ordained a member of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles. His name is Dieter F. Uchtdorf. Today, there's one stake in Czechoslovakia and a little more than 2,600 members. Okay, that was a little long before we get to the interview, but I think it will help you get some context and background knowledge to more fully enjoy Professor Woodger's interview with her colleague, Professor Casey Griffiths. So without any further ado, here's their discussion on Professor Woodger's book about Wallace F. Toronto and the Czechoslovakian mission.
Mary Jane, I'm so glad I got the opportunity to read this book. This is one of these great unknown stories in international church history that I hadn't heard before, but you make the statement in the book that Wallace Toronto is the Moses of the Czech Republic, of this particular part of Eastern Europe. And one of the things that amazed me was this is a person who never really came home from his mission. He starts out as a missionary. What's the gap between when he comes home from his first mission and when he's sent back?
About 3.5 years. He's only 27. His wife is 24 when he's called to be the mission president.
And this is as mission president. It must have obviously been a little bit different in the way it functioned back then than the way it functions right now, because it's hard for us to imagine a mission president being, you know, 3 or 4 years older than most of the missionaries that he's serving with. You mentioned in the book that Martha, his wife, for instance, the missionaries didn't feel comfortable calling her the mission mom, so they called her the mission princess because she was 24 years old.
Yeah, and it was such a, especially for her, it was such a, I think, a cultural shock because she came from such a sheltered little Intermountain West background, and then she's forced into this where she's really in charge of all the auxiliaries at age 24. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And as you said, you know, she's the same age as a lot of those missionaries, and she's the mission mom, the mission president's wife. So it's very unusual situation with him. And he actually, the first mission, his original mission, he's called to Germany. Mm-hmm. And then you have this other incredible story that I ran upon about the Bodell sisters who actually pray missionaries to come into Czechoslovakia.
Tell us a little bit about that story.
They had joined the church in Germany, and then they went back home to Czechoslovakia. And They kept writing and writing in church headquarters and saying, you know, we're the only members here. Please send us missionaries. And just praying and praying and praying. And finally, they send these five missionaries over from Germany to Czechoslovakia to open up the country. You look at Hitler, and of course, the first place he goes after is Sudetenland and Czechoslovakia. And Wally not only knows and sees that in Czechoslovakia, but in Germany, that's what's going on when he's there on his first mission before he gets transferred. So it's interesting as you read what he writes about seeing Hitler and seeing Nazism and what it's doing, and then seeing the Czech people and how they're reacting to it. And it's such a amazing story, because even in Czechoslovakia, when they leave the first time, the second time in 1939, you know, he has Jews coming to him, mm-hmm. and saying, you know, we'll join the church, please just get us out. And it's an amazing slice of history, and he's in the middle of it. And not just with Hitler, but then you go through the communist era in mm-hmm. Czechoslovakia, and he's right there in the middle of that. So it's an amazing character, not only in church history, but in Slavic history in that part of the world.
Now, and let's just make sure that our listeners kind of understand the time frame. So what year is, Wally serves a proselyting mission in Germany, winds up in Czechoslovakia. What years are those where he's serving as just a proselyting missionary? And then what year is it when he comes back as the mission president as a 27-year-old? And I should mention parenthetically here that it seems like the mission structure was that there was an apostle in London, someone like Joseph F. Merrill or Richard Lyman, who's overseeing all these smaller missions that have younger mission presidents. Yeah. But Wally was still kind of exceptional in that it seems like he's younger. And it might be because, is there nobody else that has experience with the Czech language and culture? Is that the reason why?
Well, the first mission president, before Wally gets there, Wally is going to be the mission president in 1934.
Okay, 1934.
Uh-huh. And the first mission president that's there comes with him as one of those five that are transferred from Germany. So Arthur Gaith is the first mission president, and he's unusual because he's put in as mission president as a single man, and a young man.
One thing great about the book is you kind of, there's all these pictures of Wally, and you get kind of this vision that he's kind of a big, ebullient guy, like he's got a big grin on his face, and he's always happy, and there's places in here where you talk about him making jokes in the middle of an opera or doing like bird calls in the middle.
Yeah. His wife was not happy
and
with that.
His wife is a little bit more dignified. Tell us a little bit about his background and where he came from.
Well, I think if you talk about him, you really have to talk about his grandfather. Mm-hmm. And as I tell you this story, it'll probably ring a bell. There's a story of a man by the name of mm-hmm. Joseph Toronto, who will join the church and end up in Nauvoo. This is right after the martyrdom, and they're trying to finish the Nauvoo Temple, and they run out of money. And so Joseph, as Brigham Young asks for money, will go to Brigham Young and hand him $2,500 in gold. And that's how we get the Nauvoo Temple built.
Oh, wow.
So Brigham Young, as that happens, will bless him and tell him that he will stand at the head of his race and that neither he nor his family should ever want for bread. And as I've looked at his grandson, I think Wally kind of answered that as he stands at the head of what race? The Czechoslovakian people.
Right, right.
And so you can see, you know, he's the first, Joseph Toronto is the first Italian convert to the church. And so you come, of course, Wally grows up in downtown Salt Lake, and he's just immersed in that pioneer culture and that heritage, and that's his background. As he also, his father will serve a mission to Germany, and so there's that legacy in his home. And also, you'll notice one of the gifts that when I think about President Nelson, his great gift for language, Wally is that kind of guy. Mm-hmm. And as his dad comes home and easily picked up German, then Wally goes on his mission and says, oh, this is a piece of cake. And then he goes to Czechoslovakia, and the language is much more difficult, but Wally picks it up. And I think that's one of the main reasons he became such a young mission president, is because he's one of the few Latter-day Saints on the earth that could fluently speak Czechoslovakian at the time. So,
well, and one of the things that struck me in the book is he is fearless. He's dealing with some of the scariest characters in the 20th century, Nazis and Soviets. And there was a passage that jumped out to me where two missionaries are arrested by the Gestapo after Germany takes over Czechoslovakia. You wrote, Wally goes in to see them, and it says, his patience spent, Wally finally got mad and began calling the officials some pretty hard names, the meaning of which he was unsure. When he got home, he immediately looked up the words in the German dictionary and found out that what he had said to the official, he exclaimed, oh my, and sat down and wrote a letter of apology to the offended agent. Fortunately for him, no harm stemmed from his loose tongue. And you could imagine standing face to face with the Gestapo and basically like not backing off an inch. And then, you know, a decade later, it's the KGB, it's Soviet officials. And he is confronting them directly and saying, you guys say you have religious freedom. Why don't you demonstrate it or anything like that? Like, he just seemed like he wasn't afraid.
Courageous, so courageous. And there's just, I want to go back to that, those two missionaries in prison, because that is one of the great untold stories of the church. Mm-hmm. Of course, they'd gone through a practice run in 1938 when Hitler first came into Czechoslovakia, and they kind of called it a fire drill. So in 1939, when we've got to leave again, there's no question, they kind of knew what to do. So he will, you know, plan on taking Martha and the children and the rest of the missionaries out, but then these two young missionaries don't follow the rules, and they find somebody who'll trade, you know, German marks for American dollars, and it's a Gestapo agent. So, you know, so they end up in prison. So Wally stays, and Martha goes, and she's in Copenhagen, and you know, Wally's not coming, and she's getting more nervous and more nervous and more nervous, and you can imagine. Well, even as she goes through Germany to get to Denmark, you know, the trains are packed, everyone's trying to get out, and she's getting pretty nervous. And this is what Wally's doing. He's trying to get these two missionaries out of, you know, out of prison before the war starts. And Joseph Fielding Smith just happens to be in Denmark. And she's just getting more and more nervous, and he will come and say to her, Martha, I promise you the war will not start until Wally's out. And sure enough, he leaves on the last train out of Berlin at midnight on August 31st.
Oh, wow.
And the war starts on September 1st at 5 a.m. in Poland. And so that's a wonderful prophecy that was answered. But as you talk about his courage, he wasn't going to leave those missionaries in prison.
Yeah.
And he did everything he could, and the Lord did some amazing little miracles in that situation to get him out.
Well, and it feels like a lesser person would say, okay, I've spent 6 years in the middle of this conflict. Wally comes home and maintains contact as well as he can. with the members back there. And then when the war ends, he's one of the first people back into Eastern Europe.
Oh, absolutely.
To try and find the members and make sure that they're okay, yeah, and deliver aid. It talks about him meeting with Ezra Taft Benson when President Benson is set on that relief mission,
yes,
to Eastern Europe. Talk a little bit about that, because this is a guy who goes head-to-head with Nazis. Now he's going to go head-to-head with communists as the Iron Curtain starts to fall over Eastern Europe. He's right there. In fact, he's behind the Iron Curtain for a little while.
Oh, absolutely. He'll go over in 1948, and of course, they had chopped up Europe, and Czechoslovakia ends up communist. And as he as he's there trying to find a mission home, trying to prepare so that missionaries can return, and Martha won't go for several months while he's trying to prepare things. But it's interesting as he just notices, you know, freedom after freedom taken away by the communists, and notices the reaction of Czech people, but most of all the Latter-day Saints, who had just gone through a war. And now, you know, they're going to go through this occupation. And it's interesting, the communists are very aware of Wally Toronto.
Yeah.
And by 1950, they have decided he's a spy. You know, I don't know if they have an FBI most wanted poster, but he is the most wanted person in Czechoslovakia when he leaves.
So he comes home and spends about a decade communicating with people in Czechoslovakia as best he can. And then one of the things that struck me is President McKay actually comes to him and says, hey, they're opening up for visas. Wally says, I've tried 9 times to get back in. President McKay says, why don't you try again? And they get back in. Wally and Martha go back and visit them. And you write in the book, his picture had been flashed on movie screens in Czechoslovakia and was posted in post offices as being one of the most dangerous capitalistic spies within Czechoslovakia.
Yeah, amazing, isn't it?
But he just goes in, you know.
You know, he would... he'd have to be so careful as he communicated with the saints that were left in Czechoslovakia. And he almost developed like a code, you know, a code for like if they'd had baptisms, there was a word he used or they used. And so you also realize he was never released.
Yeah.
He was, you know, never released as the mission president. So he's still got that calling.
I think.
And he's doing it, you know, de facto, you know, in Utah.
32 years as mission president.
Yeah. Is the I mean, he's got to hold the record.
Yeah.
There's no doubt he's got to hold the record for the longest tenure as a mission president.
Yeah.
But always in the back of his mind, what he wants is he wants the church to be recognized, and he wants the church to be registered so that they can come out in the open and at least, you know, have that recognition. That is always his desire.
If you're interested in more peer-reviewed, high-quality gospel scholarship about Latter-day Saint history, doctrine, or practice, such as the publication being discussed in this episode, BYU's Religious Studies Center is a great place to check out. A new Jewish and Latter-day Saint interfaith book that is just coming out is called Understanding Covenants and Communities, Jews and Latter-day Saints in Dialogue, edited by Mark S. Diamond and Andrew C. Reed. This book comes out of the Jewish Latter-day Saint Academic Dialogue Project, a groundbreaking interfaith encounter between these two religious communities. The fruit of 5 conferences that were held semi-annually since 2016, this book addresses such themes as theological foundations, sacred scriptures, lived experience in worship, and culture and politics. Although the Jewish and Latter-day Saint communities have at times been at odds, they share a number of significant historical and communal bonds. Readers will emerge with a deeper understanding and appreciation of both faith traditions. Again, the book is called Understanding Covenants and Communities, Jews and Latter-day Saints in Dialogue. Check it out and pick it up at rsc.byu.edu. We've been listening to Professor Casey Griffiths interview his colleague, Professor Mary Jane Woodger, on her history book, Mission President or Spy, The True Story of Wallace F. Toronto, the Czech Mission, and World War II. Before we go on to part two, I have to share this little side note that Professor Woodger shared in a different interview on a little insight from church history that may be unknown. It's a fact about Sister Martha Toronto, Wallace F. Toronto's wife.
Wally Toronto will die at age 60. He had been a mission president for 32 years, most of the time in de facto. But President McKay will ask Martha Toronto to become the mission president for a few months before they can find a successor. So I think she was the only female mission president we've had in the history of the church.
Okay, that's just a cool little tidbit that I wanted to share with you listeners as well. So now on to part two. For this part of Why Religion, we like to explore why this research matters to the everyday saint and what are some applicable lessons we can draw from this research. So here's Professor Woodger addressing some of those points.
If I may, so many parallels between what Wally goes through and some of the things that we're experiencing right now. I remember a month or two ago, it's spring 2020 as we're recording this, seeing missionaries called home from their missions. You talk about how that happens at the opening of World War II, that these missionaries that have labored and sacrificed for years to try and build up the church all of a sudden are just kind of ripped away. And then another part of the book that struck me is when Wally and Martha go back, they find that the church has been existing underground, that elders will go to people's homes and administer the sacrament. That reminded me so much of
what
we're doing right now.
Interesting. Well, you even look at, especially after they leave in the 50s, that those missionaries are reassigned to other missions.
Mm-hmm.
And as you said, that's happening right now. Is this reassignment. And so I think the missionaries then are under the same kind of feeling as, well, I was called to this mission, and does the Lord know that I wasn't going to finish my mission there and I'm going to go somewhere else? And one thing that I love about Wally is there's just an absolute faith in the Lord's in charge.
Yeah.
And I think that's why he could be so courageous, is because he really felt it, the Lord's hand and what was happening. And even though, you know, his great desire to have the church recognized would not happen during his lifetime, he knew it would happen.
Yeah.
And that the Lord would take care of it.
I wanted to read this excerpt when he goes back to visit. He speaks to the saints in the area, and he talks to the priesthood. He says, "Brethren, your calling in the priesthood is far greater than you could ever imagine. In the providence of the Lord, an iron curtain cannot be rung down on his gospel, cannot be rung down on the priesthood. You, brethren, are still his representatives. You still speak for him in spite of the fact that I'm not here and the missionaries are not here, and that you don't have direct contact with the president of the church. And when the time comes, brethren, if you live faithfully from here on out, continue to uphold the principles of the church, keep close to the Lord in prayer, and manifest and exercise your priesthood to the best of your ability, the day will come when you stand before the bar of God, and you shall testify of all the terrible things that have happened to your nation. You'll also testify then of the blessings the Lord has given you, those of you who have remained faithful to the covenants." And one of the things that blew me away was he goes and visits the saints, and he says that his estimate was that about 2% of them had gone less active, that 98% had stayed faithful to the church and had continued to live their covenants and bless and serve one another, even under these really, really harsh conditions.
You know, the amazing thing is, they did stay true. They did, even with all, it was the next generation where things listen up with restrictions, that they fall away a little bit. So I found that really interesting too. But especially those that had gone through Nazism and then the communists, there's some saints who, like Wally, should have their story told, because just amazing faithfulness.
Well, and like you said, another parallel with Wally and Moses is that he never really gets to see the promised land. He doesn't see the fall.
No.
He dies in 1968. But today, the church is in the Czech Republic and Slovakia, and there's temples being built in Eastern Europe. And
everything he knew would happen comes
to pass.
Yeah,
he just doesn't get to see it like Moses.
You know, I I'm doing another little project on Greece, and the mission president there was Dennis Neuenschwander, and he talks about the relationship between intensity and time, and that we go through these periods of great intensity, especially with missionary work, but then you don't see that for a long time, and mm-hmm. then you see the fruits of labor. And I really see that with Wally. And I think that's why, you know, I can talk to a current missionary, returned missionary, and they'll know who he is, because the intensity and what he did in time has brought those wonderful blessings, especially the Czech people.
Well, and if I can highlight one facet of your work, is you were very much a 20th century historian.
Yes.
When I published one of my first articles, which was on 20th century, because you're one of my mentors, my dad said, I thought all the interesting stuff ended after Brigham Young died. What made you gravitate towards the 20th century as an area of research? And not just 20th century, but middle 20th century, Eastern European, latter-day saint history is a very, very specific genre. What makes you seek out stories like this?
Well, I was just in the right place at the right time. As I was getting my doctorate, they named the College of Education at BYU after David O. McKay, School of Education. And I was asked to do the research behind David O. McKay as an educator. And so he became my great focus. And so you'll notice a lot of the work that I do revolves around that time period. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And really, for me, the 20th century takes off, the church takes off during David O. McKay. Mm-hmm. That's when we really go from being maybe an intermountain sect to a worldwide church, is with David O. McKay. And you don't find anything more exciting in church history than his era and what's going on with people like Wally, Toronto, and where we're just barely getting the international church going. And I love to teach and love to research the 20th century because nobody knows much about it. And it's such a rich, rich reservoir of church history.
You feel like there are other Wally Torontos out there waiting to be discovered and
definitely,
have their stories told.
Definitely. I've done some work in Hong Kong, in the Cook Islands, in Greece recently, and there's a Wally Toronto in all of those places. Yeah. And they really deserve to have their stories told, as they have been those modern pioneers who have gotten a foothold in those nations and brought the church to light.
I really just love that line from Professor Woodger that she just shared, quote, there's a Wally Toronto in every country. They deserve to have their stories told. So if you're interested in reading Professor Woodger's book, go to whyreligion.byu.edu where you can find a link to purchase it. On our website, we've also included a free chapter you can download from the book thanks to the Religious Studies Center. And remember that if you want to connect with us at Why Religion, comment and give insights on episodes that you've listened to, and see behind-the-scenes photos and get bonus material, give us a follow on Instagram at Why Religion Podcast. Okay, we've arrived at part three of Why Religion, where we like to talk with the professor about why the professor chose to be a religious educator, why they believe, and why they choose faith. So we wrap up this episode with Dr. Woodger sharing a little bit about both her academic career and her faith journey.
We were talking earlier about how you kind of came from a different background, and that you were teaching junior high. That's where your career started. Tell us how you made the leap from what did you teach in junior high? First of all, your
specialty? I taught home economics.
Okay.
And American history.
Oh, right on.
In junior high, and lived to tell about it.
Yeah, you're the real heroes out there. I'm learning now that I homeschool my kids.
Yeah, junior high teachers deserve a lot. I always loved religion. I loved to teach. And interesting, the whole front page of my patriarchal blessing is about teaching the gospel. And I always thought, when I first got my patriarchal blessing, I thought, well, I'll be in young women's. And interesting, I've never been in young women's once. And as time went on, I thought, well, I'll teach seminary, and I tried to teach seminary, and and that didn't work out. And I remember going in and talking to Susan Easton Black, who was the first female religion professor. And I basically said, I want to be like you, which was a ridiculous thing to say. And she said, well, you got to write. And I thought, write? I don't want to write. I want to teach. So I just started, of course, on my master's and then got my doctorate. And I was just in the right place at the right time, and had some wonderful mentors in church history and the church history department at BYU. And
you talk about Susan being one of those early pioneers, but you were too. I'm guessing there weren't very many women in religious education at the time you joined the faculty.
I was the second in the church history department to be hired.
Okay.
So, yeah. I hate to say I'm a senior faculty member. It's like revealing my age, but yeah. And I've always felt like I was kind of a pioneer and in the department and also in church history, a church historian.
Were there things that were difficult for you coming from the background, it being kind of a boys' club for you to break into and find your way?
You know, I never felt that. I felt just the opposite. I just, the administration, my colleagues at BYU bent over backwards for me to succeed. I never experienced that. I can't say enough good about my experience, especially in the Department of Church History and Doctrine at BYU. They did everything they could to make sure I would succeed. And, you know, from, you know, grants and financial support to just mentoring me in an amazing way. Mm.
Well, you've been one of my mentors, and so I'm glad that you've passed that on.
That's kind of me to
say. Mary Jane was on my, you were on my master's committee. I would go to you all the time when I was working on my PhD, and I've always been really grateful for your help.
Oh, thanks. And we actually have co-authored a couple books.
We have, yeah.
So
yeah. I'm still not quite on your level.
No.
Well, maybe just one last question. We wanted to make a focus of this podcast how a person of intellect can also be a person of faith. Can you tell us how you reconcile those two parts of your personality, the idea that you're well-read, you're articulate, you're intelligent, you're educated. You also believe in the restored gospel. How do you reconcile those two parts of your personality?
You know, there has not been much reconciliation, because the more I study, especially as I study the lives and the teachings of our prophets, there's never been a schism for me. In fact, my research and my studying has only increased my testimony. And I find that those who really research, and for instance, those who maybe go to the internet, but maybe would take the time to look at the sources, mm-hmm. and who's saying what and why, they don't have a problem. It's those who dabble and just take everything at face value that have a problem.
That's interesting, the idea that dabbling is what's dangerous, not deep learning, that it's the people that kind of skim the surface that sometimes have difficulty, not the people that
really
dive in
and
swim around.
Yeah. That's what I've really found. And I really have spent my life studying the lives of our prophets and apostles. That's what I teach. And there's just no, especially with the prophets. I truly believe when Wilfred Woodruff said they will never lead you astray, I believe that's from the time they're converted to the gospel. Of course, they're not perfect. They're men. They're human. But the more I study their lives, the more I know that they are prophets of God.
Thank you for listening to Why Religion. This podcast is a production of religious education at Brigham Young University in Provo, Utah. My name is Anthony Sweat. I'm the executive producer. The Why Religion podcast team also includes from Brigham Young University, Professors Brad Wilcox, Casey Griffiths, and Ryan Sharp. Recording and mixing were done by BYU students Mitchell Bashford and Connor Miller. Say hi, Mitchell and Connor.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
Original music and scoring for Why Religion podcast was created by the fabulous BYU student musicians Grant Cagle,
Sam Clausen,
Colette Jones,
and Alistair Scheuermann.
If you enjoy what you've heard, please like and subscribe to Why Religion on wherever you get your podcasts and leave us a rating. It really helps. And join us next time as we continue to bring the everyday Latter-day Saint fascinating gospel studies done by Brigham Young University religion professors to enlighten your mind and strengthen your faith.